Hello, Nanner here. Welcome back to Grim Dawn. We have arrived at the gates of Necropolis. So we are getting very close to our final fight with the game's end boss, the Logorian. So for this episode, we're gonna have a bit of a run through the Necropolis itself. And probably there's an area down there. It's a bit of a... not a dungeon, it's more like a catacomb, and if memory serves me correctly, there's going to be a devotion shrine there. So we're going to go over there as well. In the next episode, we're actually going to dive into the final dungeon. But before that, I realized that most of the episodes I've been just playing and filling my bags with loot. And then after the episode, I've been sorting through the loot. 99% of the stuff just gets converted into iron bits. But every once in a while, there is a little upgrade, and those I equip and I upgrade, and that's it. But haven't really done a bit of an overview of our gear in a while, so I figured now before we are gonna do the heading towards the boss fight, might as well have a little bit of an overview. So let's start top and then work around the clock. So our weapon, a puncturing assault battle axe of the Rifthound. It's a decent yellow. It's a one-hander and it has a bonus to attack speed and a bonus and just a flattened damage bonus, and that made it a decent upgrade over the previous weapon. I'm still using a hollow fang as the component inside of it because it gives me life leech and a chance to get a little bit more life leech. The bonus and conversion to vitality is actually something that reduces my damage, because I'm not really doing a lot of vitality damage while my physical damage is superb, plus 140%, while on the vitality side we're boosting ourselves by 23%. So ideally I'll actually find myself a weapon that has life leech built into it, and then I can drop the hollowed fang and replace it with something else. But for now it is a reliable way to get yourself life leech, and it is worth losing a little bit of DPS in order to get yourself life leech to sustain yourself. Then next up, a ring. A whole bunch of resistances and some damage reflection. That's the important bit here. Aether and chaos resistance are really hard to come by, so if you find decent items that offer it, it's almost a no-brainer to slot them. This is in fact our only source of aether and chaos resistance that we have right now, which might pose to be a problem. As I always tend to do, I put corpse dust into it. It boosts our health, it boosts our health regen, and it gives us a little bit of vitality resistance, all of which are good things. Our helmet, I think this is also a recent change. Gives us health, cunning is forgettable. I mean, in the end, cunning, it boosts our physical damage. So, well, maybe it's not completely forgettable, but it's not the main focus in terms of stats for us. We got pierce resistance, which is, well, if you focus a little bit on it, pierce resistance is decent to get at least above 70. And then we got some pierce retaliation and plus 2 to warcry, which helps us to just get warcry to give it an even larger radius, so it affects more monsters. I put molten skin in because at the time it actually was required in order to get our resistance over 60. And it still is. We are at 60 without and exactly at 80 with the molten skin. So this helps us just cap off our resistance. Amulet, death ward, unique amulet. Or epic amulet. It's not unique, it's epic. Stats, health, resistances, blah blah blah. The reason you pick this is for defy death. It triggers when you get below 25, and then it's basically a very strong oh damn panic button. 25% health is a bit on the low end for most builds, but given that we have over 8,000 health, that means even when we go below 25%, we still have over 2,000 health remaining, and the heal is gonna get us back up to at least over 6,000 health or so. So it's a very nice defensive item. I do eventually see myself replacing this with something else that has just stats that are more generally useful, rather than being useful in situations where you are getting whittled down. Because this doesn't help you if you go from 26% of your health to zero. It doesn't trigger then. You need to go from 26 to 24 and then it will trigger. And then there's a ward stone in here to boost our elemental and bleeding resistances. Again, just a regular ring over here. The main reason I picked this up is because it adds nearly 20 health regenerated per second, and I've put a corpse dust into it. If you have a look at our health regeneration, currently is 222. If you take this one out, we drop down to 172. So that 20 health regenerated plus the 18%, together they contribute 50 health per second. So yes, I'm really leveraging health regeneration in this build. And that's why this is a rather strong ring. Next up, a shield. A bunch of health, which is useful. A fatality resistance, fatality retaliation, and a bonus to retaliation damage. All just generally useful retaliatory fingermagics. And we put a serrated shield in here, which lowers our shield recovery time so we can block more often. And it gives us a bunch of piercing retaliation damage and a bonus to all of our retaliation damage. Top that all off, we get a brutal shield slam, which is just a rather powerful skill with a relatively short cooldown. On top of that, it also stuns the target, which is really, really useful. And it scales off of the offhand weapon damage, which is also fun. So if you have a shield with more damage, it will just boost that even further. Shoulder pads, they are low on armor, but high on stats. 5% health, 12.2 health regenerator per second, and a 26% bonus to health regen, and 23 to all elemental resistances. The elemental resistances are the main reason I picked this one up, because I needed something to fix that, and this definitely fixes that. The health is also pretty nice. There's a silk swatch in here. It's a very good way to get yourself some pierce and bleeding resistance. And that only goes into a couple of components, shoulder being one of them. Mighty Restored Gauntlets of the Stone Fist. They are really high health. Well, really, I'm saying really. It's probably not really, really high health. But there's health here, there's physique here, there's health here, there's defensive ability, pierce resist, just a decent-ish mix. And to be honest, I haven't found anything that's way better than this. And sort of okay. And a Venom Solve in here to give ourselves some resistance against poison and acid damage, as well as a bonus to our health regen. Boots, physical damage, it's nice. It definitely helps us boost our DPS a little bit. Some health, some defensive ability, some movement speed. Movement speed on boots is generally useful. And it's one of the few item slots that actually gets it, because you know, you move with your boots, it does make sense. And a chance to avoid melee attacks, which is, it's okay. I believe this is actually boots I crafted, Squire's Greaves. I think this is part of a recipe that you can craft at the blacksmith. Could be that you have to buy the blueprint for this or find it. The way to acquire blueprints is always a little bit fuzzy with things like this. It also grants a skill, Seismic Blast. And it triggers when you get hit by a critical, which is something that's currently pretty difficult to achieve, because we have a very high defensive ability, which means monsters have a difficult time hitting us, let alone critting us. So this is boots that are also a candidate for just be to get upgraded. If there's boots that offer any resistance to Aether or Chaos, for example, then it's a no-brainer to switch them out. Similarly for this one, for example. Oh, there's a solid amount of resistances on there, 52%, so that's okay. But if you find something with Aether or Chaos resistance, chances are it'll get replaced. Same here. Metal, there's a bunch of health on here, some retaliation, bonus armor, physique, just all kinds of nice defensive things, as well as the ward stone, again, just providing more resistances. Belt. Cunning offensive ability just helps a little bit with attacking. Defensive ability, it just prevents us from getting hit and crit. Chance to avoid melee attacks, it's useful. On the one hand, we want to get attacked. On the other hand, every once in a while not getting hit, it does allow us to live longer when we are just surrounded by monsters on all sides. Pierce resist, reduction in bleeding duration, they're all just minor defensive bonuses. 14% damage reflected is the main thing I actually picked this for. Together with our ring over here, we get 25% damage reflection out of the box. And plus one to fighting spirit is just nice as a skill bonus. 10% chance to trigger overguard is also rather darn useful. Because it's a separate timer from our own. This is just a level 1 overguard. Our own overguard is level 13, 12, 12. But they can trigger separately and you can actually stack them. So it's just a nice defensive bonus. Then we get Guile, our relic. The aura that it allows us to cast gives us a rather nice bonus to our damage output. And another chance to avoid melee attacks. So it gives us a lot of offense. It also boosts us with a little bit of defense. Templar's leg armor. Decent amount of armor, solid amount of health. 8% is a very, very nice bonus. Defensive ability, I seem to be picking up that up on every component we have. Some resistances and a chance of lightning retaliation. It's mostly just the combination of a lot of health, decent armor, and resists why I got it. The dense fur in here is, again, to just round out the resistances. You notice this armor provides fire and lightning resistance, so adding the dense fur here means it will provide resistance to all three of the elements, making it a reasonably balanced item. And the 90 health is just a bonus on top. And finally, we got Zolan's battle plate. I think it's also on level, yeah, it's level 40. Bonus to physical damage, bonus to pierce damage, which are damage types that we deal. More physical than pierce, if I remember correctly, though. Yeah, so we're really rather low on pierce. We do a lot of pierce reflect or retaliation damage, but that doesn't count. The percentage bonus to damage is only offensive damage, not retaliatory damage. That specifically has to be mentioned. Physique just helps us equip stuff, get life, regen, stuff like that. Chance to avoid projectiles, so deal with those pesky archers. And pierce resistance, which it's more difficult to come by than elemental resistance, so it's always nice to get it. And plus two to Zolhand's technique, which is one of our offensive skills, or a triggered offensive skill. Rotten Heart in here is yet another component that allows us to do some retaliation damage, and this time it's acid retaliation damage. And as well as boosting our poison and chaos damage, which we don't actually do. And the offensive ability is a nice bonus. So there you have it, all the gear that we are currently equipping. The skills, they show up often enough. The devotion tree is something I've been talking about often enough, but gear tends to get forgotten about a little bit because, well, it's not the most interesting bit, it's just stats. But overall, all the small incremental gear changes in the end do help to shape the build. So I figured this would be a good time to put some emphasis on that. Before we get into truly scary areas. One thing that scares me the most right now is going into the Logorian's area without a very high ether resistance. Similar to going into the Obsidian Throne without proper chaos resistance. In hindsight, that did turn out okay. Ooh, Starfire. That's an epic ring. Bonus to Trojan's Sky Shards and a whole bunch of lightning and frostburn damage. And 16 to elemental resistances. So that's a little bit of a defensive component to it. That said though, we're not an arcanist, we're not a caster. We're not using those elements, so it's gonna be a waste for us. There will be better things that we can equip.
I can't do that yet.
That's it. Hello. Yeah, you just go sit with it. And just don't get up. I think that's probably gonna be best for everybody involved here. Okay, and I think we're gonna secure the inner necropolis, and after that we have to dispose of some blood wagons.
That skill's not ready.
I realize I have been talking about that gear for quite a bit. A bit further into the episode than I would have expected to. Well, as I said, it's useful to every once in a while pay some attention to gear. Even if it's just so I have a moment that I can point back to where I mentioned that I was low on ether resistance and that's what killed me in the end, so don't do this at home, kids. Could be. You never know. Now, as I also mentioned before, we have a very high life pool and we have a very decent amount of health regen. So lower resistances of some sorts means yes, we do take more damage, but we have a very decent capacity for dealing with that damage, or at least for recovering from the damage we do take. Also, we might have Bloodrinker as an ability, but we haven't actually equipped it. So whenever you change weapons, and this axe is something that we found last episode and I upgraded into it.
The
whole ritual is you take your old weapon, you go to the inventor in Act 1, give the item to the inventor, you click the button, keep the modifier, or keep the component. So the item gets trashed, you get your blood drinker back. And then you put you get your Hollow Fang back, to be more specific. Then you put the Hollow Fang in the new item and equip it. Does mean that Hollow Fang drops off of your skill bar. You have to reapply it. Alternatively, you can craft yourself another Hollow Fang and put it in a new weapon and then switch them. Then, no, you won't have the problem of losing access to that ability and it will remain on your skill bar.
I can't do that yet.
Well, if you're just using yellow weapons or truly or green weapons that you really have grown out of, and there's no real point in keeping it, and then you might as well just trash the old item and reuse your components. Okay. Now we're getting somewhere.
That skill's not ready.
You know what? We can actually just keep those blood wagons for next episode. Doing the blood wagons and then diving into the pit, that seems like thematically appropriate thing to do. So we're gonna go and have some fun with the undead in their little catacombs of thingamajig this episode.
Can't do that yet.
Yeah. As you're used to by now, I don't usually have a very strictly defined plan. I tend to deal more with guidelines. They work way better for me. Also, there is a cursed smith here. If you want to craft stuff, you can do that. There's some special materials that you can exchange for other things. And there are some things that you can craft here that I think you cannot do. And I think it mostly has to do with transforming these materials from one type to another. Yes, they're not going to be efficient. I mean, trading an ancient heart for a Blood of Catan. Usually it's easier to come by a Blood of Catan, but if you desperately need one and you don't feel like farming, this is a good place to actually fix that. Oh, and we did find some more blueprints for relics. So at some point I probably should start thinking about if there's going to be a transcendent relic that's going to be better for us, but problem with those is, of course, you need to find them and you also need to be able to craft all of these other relics, and you need to be lucky enough with the drops for the relics there. So the thing is, this smith, it's nice to find him, but I always forget where he is when I want to go back to him. So I end up clearing most of the gates of Necropolis to actually get here. He's pretty well tucked away. And he's got this small smith hammer icon on the map. But it's it really does blend in nicely against the background, so you don't really notice him. It's almost as if they borrowed the Path of Exile minimap engine for this. Oh, the larger map is better though. There you can actually see that it's something. A hammer. Okay, just picking up the loot here. I do realize there was a portal here somewhere. Yet. Trying to just go to that one. But rather than doing a full clear, we'll just be heading straight towards a goal.
That skill's not ready. I can't do that yet.
Okay, if I were looking for the portal, where would that hide? Why am I just completely overshooting it, and is it actually in there? Might just be. Okay. Yeah, portal. Come on. We have an epic to deal with. Yes, Lucius Bloodboil.
That skill's not ready.
Well, if it's going along like this, then I don't think he'll ever actually get to cast a skill. Ah, he cast one whole skill. Good for him. And we got a scepter. Okay.
I can't do that yet.
So this necropolis is a little bit of a maze. It always makes sense once you actually have found everything. Then it's like, oh yeah, wait, this was how it worked. But if you're just going through it the first time on the character, then it was a little bit of a mystery of how things work. Ooh, that was a lot of damage that we took them. Ah, so there is the crypt that I would like to go to.
That skill's not ready.
But seeing the crypt there also lets me know that I'm a bit too far south and we do need to head further up. So you can just follow along. Ah, or kill yourself in two hits, that's fine as well. The retaliation damage does seem to work rather well for us. Just look at these little devourers just devour themselves. Or stun themselves. Do have a chance to stun things that attack us. And a devotion shrine here. Ooh, haha. It's desecrated, so there's gonna be some extra spawns.
I can't do that yet.
Okay, doing some extra fire damage here. That is one of the nice things about the Actonians. They no longer deal only chaos damage. They are also pretty well into vitality and fire damage. That's basically all the elements that you would expect a demon to do.
Skill's not ready.
So is that burning on the ground or just on me? And there we have it, and then that was that, and that gets us another devotion point. Devotion points, we're using them all in a defensive manner, so the more the merrier. We're gonna go for the Wolverine up here. More defensive ability, so yeah, that ability of that's gonna do crits for us. Yeah, not happening, but this one is gonna be nice though. Another bonus to piercing retaliation, yes please. Right. Okay, now it feels like we are indeed just tracing around, so we'll probably need to head a bit to the left. That waving over here was in relation to the minimap, not to the screen, in case that confused you. So I can understand it doing that.
I can't do that yet.
Things sometimes make more sense in your own head, and they really don't make any sense if you don't properly explain them. Ah, and there we are. Hello, portal. Ah, oh no.
I can't do that yet.
They're trying to bite my legs off. Okay. We'll just shout at them. Stop biting my legs off. Those tyrants, the yellow, that means they are not as likely to kill themselves. So let's help them a little bit. So they're actually going down rather well, but of course we have a lot of AoE or multi-target abilities, so that does help. Okay, so Big Bad is the one we want to be focusing on here. Everything else is gonna kill itself way before we finish killing this guy. And so far we're doing a pretty decent job of tanking the damage. So I'm trying to see how far we can push this. There is an Overguard active to give us a bunch of regen. Now the Overguard has worn off, as you can see. And now his life has worn off. And portal unlocked. Is there heroic spoils? Yes. I was really thinking, that's a bit of a weird shimmer in there. Don't want to miss out on the loot. And then we have our buddy Olgrim. Hello there.
Took you long enough. Though I thought I'd have to save the world all by myself.
Of course, Mr. Heroic.
The cult of Cathan is too numerous for us to take them head on. But we can sabotage their efforts with a few precise attacks while our Black Legion friends keep them distracted elsewhere.
So, what's the plan, Stan?
It appears that the ritual is being powered by blood harvested at the cult's camps, delivered here in despicable blood wagons. To complicate matters, the constant flow of blood is maintaining a Cathonic seal over the entrance to the Tomb of the Watchers. I may be able to breach it with some effort, but there is no way you would be able to follow me through. You will have to disrupt the blood deliveries first. The tomb itself is split into three levels, with the bottom floor sealed off behind ancient wards. But if the cult is delivering blood in those quantities, then they must have already broken through them. I'm going to enter the tomb and see if I can disrupt the ritual from inside. In the meantime, you should deal with the blood wagons. When you're finished, join me on the bottom level, just beyond the seal of the Lughorian. With luck, we will stop the cult of Cathan before the Lughorian even moves a tentacled limb.
Okay, we will do that. So, we gain the level. Which means more points into the Demolitionist. And we have reached 5 points, so we can get our very first skill, Flame Touched. Which is gonna reserve yet more energy. But it's also gonna boost our damage by a little bit and give us some more offensive ability. So, let's see, Flame Touched. Our current damage per second is 1502. With Flame Touched, it becomes 1511. Yeah, it's not really a lot yet. But we're not really doing a lot of fire damage, so it's basically the 4 fire damage that's being taken, that's being transformed here. The reason we are taking it is just a warm up to get Temper, which is gonna boost our retaliation damage. So we're gonna keep this one at 1 point, and we don't really care about putting more points into it. Not now at least, because it's only gonna drain more of our energy, and we're not gonna gain the full benefit of it. So it's just a dependency for Temper. And of course another point into Physique, because we need even more damage. And with that, I think we're gonna...
within the Tomb of the Watchers. Just...
I think we're gonna actually call this an end to the episode. We're at about half an hour now, so that's a good point. We have achieved a nice milestone. So then next time, we're gonna go into the crypt and depending on if there's time, we'll also do the Blood Wagons. If not, then the episode after that is going to be Blood Wagons followed by the Logorian. So we are close, but I'm still trying to just maintain a decent balance in terms of how long episodes are and how much content is going to be in one. But for now, let's switch back. I'm going to thank you very much for watching. I'll see you again next time. Bye bye.